Hey everybody, thank you for hanging out for today's video. We're going over some skills that you need as a junior developer. Now, these are not only technical skills, but they are soft skills as well. So you're going to want to stay tuned and figure out what they are and check them off if you've got them. If you don't, then brush up on how you can do better at those, okay? So let's go. So let's start with soft skills because, you know, these are the skills that people usually don't think too much about and then just like, oh, it's fine, no big deal. I got the technical stuff, but that's great. It's great that you have the technical skills, but you also need the soft skills to go along with those. So one of the very big ones is communication. You are gonna have to communicate with team members. You're gonna have to communicate with possible stakeholders. You're gonna have to communicate with the product team, the QA team. So usually it's, you're gonna communicate with a lot of people. You do not know whom you'll be communicating with until you go through the interview process. But the big takeaway here is you will be communicating. The common misconception is that you are going to be by yourself, secluded in a corner, coding in the dark by your lonesome. And that is a very rare possibility. So assume that you will be on a team and that you will have to communicate to other team members because that is more than most likely going to be the case for you. You're going to have to collaborate with those team members as well and be able to talk to them about what you need from them. If there's certain things that you're going to need, then you're going to have to talk to those people and, you know, gather the information that you need from them. With this also comes speaking up if you can't meet deadlines. Usually your work is going to be deadline driven and you might have to work in sprint cycles. You might have to work in a different kind of cycle, but typically there's some sort of deadline associated with the work that you're doing. And with that, if you can't meet that deadline, then you need to speak up in meetings and talk about how you can't meet that deadline or if there's something blocking you from meeting that deadline. But the point is, you're gonna have to talk about these issues. Time management slash organization. So I've mentioned before when you have a deadline and things like that. So sometimes you'll also have projects that you're working on where you have to push back. So say that you're working directly with a team within the company, so like the sales team, or you're working with the HR team or something, depending on what kind of project, what kind of company you're working on. Who knows, you might be working across departments. Either way, you will have to communicate anything that you are not going to be able to deliver upon. Usually business and like product teams and things like that, they're like, oh, we want to do these outlandish things and we want this feature and that feature. And you might be the person that decides whether or not you'll be able to make that happen. The reason I included this is because eventually, I'm assuming you're going into the junior level, you want to be at that senior level one day. So I still think it's a good practice to know kind of what it takes to get there before you are there. And so just because you're just at the junior level now does not mean that you can't one day be at the senior level. Along with organization, time management comes working again, like I said, with deadlines. You're gonna have to know how long it takes you to complete projects and tasks and things of that nature. That is going to come with time for sure. It's a pretty good practice to start doing that now, to say, okay, I think it's going to take me X amount of time to finish this, and then seeing if you could meet that deadline. And if you can't meet that deadline, then maybe take away time or add more time, depending on, you know, if you went over or what have you. But it's definitely good to keep that in mind as you're working so that you could make sure that you're just being cognitive of what you can do and the amount of time that you can do it in. Because the last thing you want to do is say that you can do something and then you need more time, and then you consistently say that you're going to do something and then you always need more time to get it done. Like, you want to meet the mark more than you miss the mark. Hopefully that makes sense. This next section, I'm just going to call it like an overall big picture of the company. So one thing that you need is empathy for the users that is using your product or service. And so it's very important that you know, as you get into a company, you understand how the users use your product or service for the company and the value that they get from that and all these other things. So it's very important that you have that already squared away and that you continue to, you're going to continue to learn and figure these things out, of course, but you need like a very basic approach when you first get into the company. So that's one of those things, like as soon as you get started and even throughout the interview process, ask questions that can clarify exactly like your users and what those users expect from your product and the value that they get from your product or service, because that is going to that means a lot to how you go about solving the problems for the company based on the users, how they use your product. So keep that in mind. Every new feature that you are adding to the code base affects the end user. So also keep that in mind as you're coding and as you're getting these new features as well. It's like, okay, this is going to impact the code base and the code base is going to impact the end user. So if you're continuing to add so much code for like a small feature, then that is not good practice at all. So you want to make sure that you're writing efficient code as well, but you want to keep in mind that end user throughout this whole process. And also when it comes to like the code base, how is it affecting it overall? And how does that bottom line affect the company as well? So keep those things in mind. The last section is adaptability. Okay, so as developers, we are constantly having to change and adapt to different things. Technology is changing, products are changing, people are changing. So we are constantly having to adapt to one thing or another. So it's just one thing that you need to have in the back of your head. Like nothing is set in stone. Things may change and that's okay. Sometimes you'll write code for something, you know, it may not be brought into production and that's okay. That's happened to me before. I've written code and then it's not brought into production and it becomes like research and development or something of that nature. So say adaptability, because don't feel like so connected to it that you're just like so upset that your code didn't make it in. It's just, it's no hard feelings. It all goes back to the company and what's good for the business overall, what's good for the users. And so it all goes back to those things. And so don't take things personally like that, because it happens. It sometimes happens. Now, if it's consistently happening and you are not part of the research and development team, then you may have a problem. If it happens every so often, then don't take light of it and just learn from it, because you, at the end of the day, you coded, you created something. And so don't forget that everything that you're doing, you're still learning, you're still growing. So don't forget that. Also, in terms of adaptability, sometimes you're working on something and then someone may ping you and say, hey, can you work on this instead? Like a bug came up. And it could be a bug that you had something to do with. Like, let's say you pushed a feature last week. This week, there's a new bug and you're just like, oh no, this had something to do with the code that I just changed. And they may ping you, a teammate may ping you and say, hey, we need you to jump on this right away. So that's what I mean by adaptability. Like you might have planned that you're gonna work on three things today. And by the end of the day, you got to none of those things because you may have had to fix something else, or you may have had to pivot because of other things going on within the company. So just keep that in mind as you are going about your process as well. If you're enjoying this video so far, make sure to give it a like. I would appreciate it. The algorithm would appreciate it. I mean, everyone wins. Like, and you should feel happy about it too, that you gave this video a like. So come on, just do it. It's fine. It costs you nothing. It's free. Subscribe if you haven't already. Let's just do it. Let's connect. Are these the skills that you expected to see? Like, are these the soft skills that you expected to see? Let me know in the comments below. Also, if you have some additional skills that I didn't mention that are soft skills that are needed that you felt should have been in this list, let me know below as well. I would love to hear from you all. Right. Technical skills. This is a short list because it's gonna vary depend on like your job and all these other things, but we'll just go over a general overview of things that you may need to know in the technology department. So of course, right off the bat, you gotta know coding, you gotta have those skills. So you're doing it, you got it, you know the things, you got the stuff that does the things, that does the things, that got you the job. So Let's talk more problem solving. So hopefully you have been problem solving throughout your time of like creating projects and things of that nature, and you've shown that ability. If you're in the job hunt process now and you're trying to show that ability right now, then it's always best to do that with a past project that you've worked on. And if you have not worked on a past project, I recommend that you do so, so that you can have some talking points when it comes to your interview and how you solved problems, your process, your approach. All those things are important. Reading other people's code. Okay, this is a big one. Now, I can't tell you how important this is. So it's very important that you're able to go in and like understand like a general high level overview of somebody else's code. And that just comes with practice. So how do you practice? You go and you go on GitHub and you look at some open source stuff. You go and you look at documentation and all these other things. You get involved in the community and you just look at code. That's all you can do to really get better at it. And I say go look at documentation because documentation has code examples in there as well. You didn't write those code examples. So go in and kind of look at those things as well. And if you can understand it at a high level overview, then good for you. If you can't, then spend a little bit of time there just really trying to understand those, the idea and what they're trying to get across to you. And I'd say continue to put that into practice daily if you can. Just read other people's code and try to understand it. Now, this kind of goes back to something I mentioned in the other part of this, in the soft skills portion, which was being able to estimate how long a task or project takes you. Now, I did mention that it will take time to do this, but it's a skill that you need to have on the technical end because you need to know your own abilities and how long it's going to take you to code something. And again, this is just going to come with practice. So as you get more assignments and coding tasks and stories, whatever they call them at your place of work, then you will get more adaptable to like how long it's going to take you to do something, what you need to do, and all those other things. It just comes with time, honestly, and it's a lot of practice, like putting it into practice. And so that's it. Those are the things. Hopefully this video was helpful for you. If it was, make sure to give it a like. And if you have any additional comments, throw them down below. And then just thank you all for the support on all my videos. Thank you for watching my content. Thank you for subscribing to the channel. I definitely do appreciate it. Anytime somebody subscribes and likes the videos and all this other stuff, you don't realize the importance that it is to me. So thank you so much for that support. Until next time, take care of yourself and be nice to others. Bye.